So here we are in historic Marshville, a village in Waynefleet.
My first time here?
Yes, this one-room schoolhouse built in 1866, so nice of them to let us come film here.
Really, very nice. It's a really beautiful facility.
I love these desks.
A little cramped.
Not designed for me to turning around. I should be really facing.
Well, this is to prevent you from passing notes back.
Passing notes back, cheating on the readings, which are actually really interesting this week.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they fit together all very nicely. Talking about institutions, schools, prisons, and asylums. I was confused why hospitals weren't an institution, but you explained that.
The mind, not the body.
Right.
Although, certainly, interestingly, I mean, we don't need to go too far into this, but there's a kind of Foucauldian, Michel Foucault kind of angle in some of these readings. And certainly he would emphasize that discipline is on the mind and on the body all the time.
Speaking of that,
there is a connection. Exactly. People may not recognize, many of our students may not recognize this.
I know. This is a strap. So this
did you ever get the strap?
No, of course not. I was a very well-behaved child, but there was a strap hanging up in the principal's office that I did happen to see. It was, you know, the fear of the strap was definitely, I think that's also a book.
No, absolutely. That's how discipline works.
The threat of discipline, which is similar to prisons, but, you know, in the school setting. Also the fear of being isolated and embarrassed in front of your peers. Although I love these desks because they range from tiny to very large because of
I'm not sure, because perhaps in our shot we can see the tiny little desks behind us over there.
Yeah.
They're quite tiny.
So it was not just my peers I would be embarrassed in front of them, but basically the entire community.
And your family too, because many of these families are quite large, and so you'd have a sibling over there and a sibling over there, or that kind of situation as well.
They might tell on me if I misbehaved.
Exactly, when you go home, you can't bluff mom.
I wore the dunce cap today.
Yeah. And it also has that simultaneous schooling, educative technique happening here. In the screencast, we talked a bit about Bishop Strawn and his education of elite members of the Canadian society. But he's taking one or two or sometimes three people, you know, in the course of a week or a month into his home for particular forms of education. This is different. This is mass schooling. So we think of this as a kind of cute, quaint little one-room schoolhouse from the pioneer days. But in fact, this is a modern technology of education being deployed here, ranging from, I'm going to guess these people are 12 or 14 over there to the little ones over here.
This is a farming community, so it's quite similar to how it would have been in many of the schoolhouses would have been for the farmers' children.
Right.
And so there's that interesting conflict that you read about whether they want to be sending their children off to school. I mean, they probably want them to be educated, but also at the same time they need the labor.
Yeah. There's all kinds of interesting debates going on about schools. We think of them as kind of a common sense thing, but many, particularly rural people, but farmers in particular, aren't happy about losing the labor of the children going into schools because they have things to do on the farms.
Mm-hmm.
But also above that, at the elite level, at the political level, early in the educational reform situation, there's a real sense that these schools are not effective schools, these are not good schools, it's just something you're giving to the poor. That a real school will train people to be a clergyman or a lawyer or something elite like that. So it's more a collegiate kind of English, Oxford, Cambridge, Glasgow, Edinburgh kind of model of education rather than mass education of this sort.
But Ryerson points to how he thinks it should, you know, it's important for everybody to have it, but it should also be very practical.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting. All of the institutions. Very expensive to build these buildings and run them and be a public service.
Yeah.
I could see, I mean, the debate is still on now about my tax dollars.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's interesting, so these farmers being taxed for things that perhaps they didn't even want.
Yeah, no, exactly. So there's that kind of double resistance. You're giving me something that I don't want and making me pay for it. So there's, and again, these are things that we, you know, there's people, as you say, people complain about taxes, but they also accept at the basic level that they have to pay them. In the 1830s, 40s, 50s, yes, they pay some small taxes, but not many. So to suddenly be confronted with a school tax, and as time goes on, more and more taxes to pay for these institutions become incredibly expensive to operate. Look at those prisons, look at those insane asylums. Those are big institutions. You're building schools in all these communities all over the province. A lot of money. You have to hire teachers, you have to hire staff, you have to maintain the grounds. And, endless numbers of costs attached to these things.
The thing that comes in really interesting to me is the historical thinking aspect. When you go back to think of how people would have viewed it at that time, right now we sort of take it for granted that we would have places for people to go to school. Mm-hmm. Public school is a given. Mm-hmm. You know, a prison is pretty much a given. Mm-hmm. Like, we're not going to abolish prisons, but it was, you know, at their time of building, it was sort of, you know, not, there was some resistance to it.
Oh, absolutely. And you see also in our readings that even, so there's a, you see nice examples in Daniel Francis's essay about the lunatic asylums in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, where there's a theory in place that they think they can reform people, they can help people.
Right.
But if they don't have the dollars to actually build the institution that will do that, it's not going to happen. So, you know, suddenly they're saying, well, we have this idea, and people are saying, you have an idea, you know, it's going to cost me money. And you get into those debates again about spending a lot of money on a practice that is not proven, it's not clear.
Right.
And yet there is also an increasing, and again, the tours give you a nice sense of selling that to the public, showing people the value of their taxes being spent. There is a sales job underway here to convince people that this is what's necessary to live in a democratic society.
And yet, many of the methodologies that were, you know, that took place in schools and in asylums, particularly, you know, don't exist anymore because the people decided that was not
right.
very effective
right.
or humane yeah. way of treating people generally.
Yeah, there's little lessons there for us in social science and science in general that, you know, our paradigms are changing all the time. What we think is a sure cure for something often proves itself not to be.
Really interesting. Is there anything in particular we should look at for in our primary sources or the essays that we haven't talked on?
I think they point nicely to, I guess, a kind of experimental nature of this, where they're trying things and it's not actually happening. Certainly in the examples of the school system, we certainly see kind of, you know, this kind of discipline more than the kind of discipline of the mind kind of stuff. They're certainly related, but you know, this is kind of more explicit technique. But it's certainly a general questions that we can raise about behavior modification, how they're thinking about the big picture, society, and yet at the same time the individual and shaping the individual to somehow fit into that society. This is kind of abstract, kind of sociological stuff that goes beyond what we often do in history, but that's exactly what's going on in these institutions. They're thinking big, they're thinking about structuring, building a society, and it's a new society, and as we keep emphasizing in this course, it's a liberal democratic society. How do you make that work? How do you change people? How do you teach them to act in that kind of society?
And if you think of the people in particular, very unique because of all these different sort where they've come from all over the place and this new lifestyle. So it's a really interesting way to use it through history to look at those sociology type questions.
One thing we could mention, and again it's become kind of a theme in the course, is the role of evangelicals. Again, Ryerson, who we,
right.
remember we met him at the church a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
He's a Methodist. And part of that kind of, the simple fact that all these people, they can, well, most of them are actually evangelicals, or Presbyterians and Methodists and so on, but because they can get to heaven, because they merit that place in God's eyes, they should be receiving an education. There's a connection
right.
There between mass schooling and this evangelical approach that says we should be giving this to all people. Including women, young girls come to the school. They deserve an education too. They should have an education too. They can be trained to be brought up to be good citizens of that flag, but also to be godly in that kind of Presbyterian, Methodist, evangelical kind of way.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It's interesting to look at it from this week, looking back for all the other weeks I've been reading. So I'm excited to see what people come up with their own analyses.
Yeah, lots of cool stuff there.
All right.
School's out.